advent of MTV revolutionized the way generations perceive the world around them more perhaps than any other phenomenon in postmodern culture. Suddenly, music was transformed from something we listen to into something we watch. Okay, it is true that classical opera is also music we can watch. But in opera, the visual is a specific story with a fairly rigid limits on interpretive freedom. Not so in music videos. Music videos defy our old conceptions of plot and storyline by presenting a stockpile of images, some obvious, others completely mysterious, in conjunction with the music. The audio and visual merge and become a new and separate creation, the music video. Electronic culture is a culture of multiple impressions, where audio and visual simulation bombard us with images and snippets of pictures, posts, snaps, and tweets, while leaving the bulk of interpretation to the observer. Now, the greatest image creator throughout human history has been the church. Long before literacy, theology, or philosophy, there were images, symbols that spoke to people about God. So now, if postmodern culture is an image glutton, shouldn't this, to use an image, put the church in the catbird seat? So why is it then that the church is perceived by so many today as a lackluster, out-of-step, dry-bones institution? Why do we risk becoming as irrelevant as the dodo bird? Maybe because, like a catbird seat, no one is quite sure what the church's images are supposed to mean today. What the heck is a catbird seat anyway? One ecclesiastical image that still gets attention showed up on a lot of people's foreheads on Wednesday. Gray crosses of ash smudged above the brow. A signal marking the beginning of Lent, hearing, remember, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. Lent, the 40 days preceding Easter, the great feast, is a time of prayer and penitence, a journey through the wilderness to a cross. And it begins with dust and ashes, the residue of burned out fires and burned up stars. Nothing would seems so appropriate, symbolic of the lousy state of humanity. Cold and lifeless, ashes make it clear that nothing is right. That human beings have settled in the dust and settled for the worst, when we might have taken wing into the heavens and flown into the stars. Tragically, our fallenness, our not rightness, took center stage this particular Ash Wednesday, as yet again, classrooms became killing fields. Who could possibly deny our brokenness, our need for a savior? But ashes are also made of carbon, the building blocks of life. So before relegating Lent simply to the season of ashes, a 40-day moan and groan and woe is me, woe are we session, look at the next image that the church offers people this time of the year. Fast on the heels of palms reduced to cold gray ashes marking our death, the first Sunday of Lent, we hear about the arrival of a living, soaring dove of the Spirit, slipping out of heaven and into our world. You are my son, my beloved. On Wednesday, the church proclaims a 40-day period of repentance and fasting. On Sunday, Jesus proclaims the kingdom of God has come near. On Wednesday, we are marked with the ashes of our finitude and mortality. On Sunday, we see the promise of eternal life as Jesus rises up out of the baptismal waters. The dove descending from heaven demonstrates how the Holy Spirit gets back into our world. In the midst of our ashes, the dove as a symbol says to us, you can be a diamond someday. Malcolm Forbes used to like to say that diamonds are nothing more than chunks of coal that stuck to their jobs. For the Christian, the season of Lent reminds us that diamonds are nothing more than carbon ashes that have been touched and transformed by the dove. The dove told Noah everything would be all right after the flood. In Psalm 68, the dove's silvery, iridescent feathers represent the cloud of Yahweh's comforting presence to Israel. The dove, for that is the meaning of Jonah's name, came to Nineveh and warned her to repent, and in doing so, Nineveh was saved. The Holy Spirit descends as a dove at the moment of Jesus' baptisms and enters him. The Holy Spirit come back into the world, but not yet accessible to all. It is only after Easter, after Christ's death and resurrection, that the Holy Spirit is made accessible to the whole wide world. At Pentecost, the dove as the Spirit became flames. The dead lump of burned up ashes is reignited by the fanning wing beats of the dove of love, and it bursts into the tongues of the Holy Spirit fire. Pile of ash, a dove of love, a tongue of fire. The church, we have the images. The church has the music. So why can't the church mix these metaphors together in ways that are relevant for a post-MTV generation? What's sapping the energy out of our images, making them appear as ghostly and out of focus, like a snowy old black and white TV for those of you who can remember? Maybe it's because the church has forgotten the contrast button. Images are only well-defined and clearly distinguishable when they sharply contrast with the background of the picture. The gospel writers certainly knew the power of contrast. For why else is the Holy Spirit introduced as a beautiful, gentle dove and then immediately depicted as this driving force jettisoning Jesus into the wilderness? Contrast. In the wilderness, the Spirit as a dove is itself a contrast to those other inhabitants, the wild beasts. Contrast. The Hebrew people lived on the edges of a vast wilderness of dry, barren land where the presence of water was never taken for granted. Water was life-giving. Water was a blessing. And yet, what image does the Old Testament use to illustrate a raging fit of divinely mandated destruction? A flood. Contrast. In order to celebrate God's blessing of Christ's presence in our lives, we need to be able to acknowledge the curses that accompany life. There are ashes. There are wild beasts. There is evil. And that's just inside the church. Washington is more than we have time for today. The church must be willing to have as high a doctrine of the corruption of the church as it has of the grace of God. We need almost as high a concept of evil as of good. Without black and white, everything is gray. And all the gray images in the world won't show up against an equally gray background. And so where do you find direction? The story is told of a seminary professor who would ask each new group of seminary students in his classes, "What made you feel like God was calling you to the ministry?" Inevitably, some poor, unsuspecting soul would say, "Well, I like working with people." And the professor would look that student right in the eye and say, "My friend, you haven't met many of the people you're going to be working with, have you? Some of them just aren't all that nice." It's true, you know. For laity and clergy alike, most of us, some of the time, and some of us, most of the time, are not all that easy to like. But the good news of the cross is that God does not love us because we are all that nice, or neat, or socially acceptable, or easy to like. God does not save us because we believe the right things, or say the right things, or do the right things. The great good news of the gospel is that God shows God's love for us while we were yet sinners. Christ died for us. God loves us. Ordinary, everyday, standard brand, ashy sinners that we are. And offers us the extravagant gift of forgiveness and grace. Now that's a contrast worthy of being spread wide and far. A contrast we would be remiss not to share with our brothers and sisters that we work with, that we live with, that we run across in the street, that we meet in the supermarket. It is Lent, a time of ashes, a season for acknowledging the bad smell of a corrupted humanity in the air. But without that smell in our nostrils, we might well fail to notice when the wings of the Holy Spirit start beating the sweet, fresh air of Christ's redeeming love into our lungs. Do you feel the air move? And we might tragically miss the invitation of the Spirit to transform our ashes into diamonds. Remember, you are dust. To dust you shall return. But also remember that through the power of the cross and empty tomb, dust need not mark our end. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.